Reiterating the point that it's not necessarily a group of classes that are just about the four regulative principles. So today's class is about intoxication, nobody need for sure. It's about the pillars of freedom. So they, like last week, talk about a lot more, like we didn't talk about necessarily the success last week. It was more the foundation of tolerating desires, then that principle is there, that okay, yes, no, this is sex, well, why is that there? How does it form a pillar of devotion by automatically doing that? And then getting into the maybe some of the things which aren't necessarily breaking regulative principles, but they are to do with the principles behind those regulative principles. So like today, we talk about austerity and mercy. So no intoxication links to austerity. So the principle of austerity being staying awake in class. or many other things. Anyway, that we have, you know, a practice that is enforced by this regulative principle, but can encompass an awful lot more things than just that regulative principle. Like just by following that principle of non-intoxication doesn't necessarily mean austere. It may give us the groundwork for practicing austerity with a very, very gross kind of promise, like, okay, yeah, I'm not going to get intoxicated. So in the West these days, it's a given that most people have probably tried some type of intense intoxication, like some kind of drugs, hallucinogenics or whatever, or even alcohol, or cigarettes, something. It's very rare that somebody hasn't tried something. Everyone has. I used to find it funny, you know, sometimes I'd have relatives, you know, my brother would be heavy on one type of intoxication, and he'd be really heavy on it while he was down in pint after pint after pint of lager and getting completely intoxicated and inebriated and then, you know, almost looking for a fight because the players are a lot bigger than me. But yeah, he'd be condemning people that were getting stoned or, you know, using cocaine or heroin, but then himself being engaged in one sort, or my mother, you know, smoked at least 40 cigarettes a day for most of her life. I say most of her life because it wasn't like she stopped at the end of her life, it was like she had all the time before she started smoking. But she started smoking at a young age, like I think she turned 11 or 12. And yet, with this very dangerous habit, which she couldn't do without. You know, she would then condemn some of the others. So generally, we've all had something. And then in this day and age, more modern day and age, there's, I was listening to the radio the other day, and they were talking about how the new generation, Generation Z, I think it's getting called, doesn't, you know, they're not so into drugs or alcohol. These are all going off to universities, and they're asking for places that, okay, can these be alcohol or drug-free houses, where we know people aren't going to do this. And they're saying, well, they're making this big thing, saying, oh, you know, this new generation, they're into healthy eating. It's like the Instagram generation, they called it, where everything's like about your body image and you've got to be healthy and it's all about that. And then they're saying, but then the problem is, yeah, they're not drinking, but they're really into these supplements instead. And so they've just changed one type of addiction to another type of addiction. So they're getting body buzzes. In other words, it's all about, okay, I have to get this photo, so therefore I take this supplement, this supplement, this supplement. And then when they get on their certain body buzz, then they get this sense of worth, but they're actually damaging their body because all they're doing is living off supplements, which, if you're just drinking supplements every day, it's not actually good for you because your body needs to go through the process of digesting food. It needs that fire in the belly. There's a devotee who used to be in the American Marines, very nice devotee. Seen some really harsh things. He was in the Gulf when it was all kicking off. And pretty much because he was a vegetarian, he stuck to his principles, he was just living off protein shakes and nuts and pulses, raw, because that's all he could have out in the desert. They weren't really in the war zone. He said, well, are you a vegetarian? Okay. Look at this meal, here you go. It was like, no, this is your rations for the day. If you don't want that, well, here's some nuts. Or, well, we've got these protein shakes. And after 4 years of that, his digestive system was shot. So now, he's not in the Marines anymore, but he can't eat like a normal meal that we could, because his digestive system just can't cope with it. He'd get sick, he'd have diarrhea, he'd be vomiting, because his body hadn't been doing what it was supposed to do. So he was getting all the nutrients, he was getting the proteins, but his body wasn't acting as it should. Yeah. So you have this new generation which they're getting intoxicated in a different way. It's not in the general way which we look at of being, oh yeah, drugs, drink, whatever, but it's still this kind of focus on, well, if I do this, this and this, really heavily focused on my body, I get this many likes or this many followers, then they're getting a buzz. Now that may not be seen as a gross thing of saying breaking four of the principles of like, oh yeah, I'm getting intoxicated by this fame, or you know, you get protein highs. I remember a long time ago having some pea protein, which would give me a headache. You get other people with different body types and they'd be like, you know, they'd have their protein shake and then they'd be like, they'd be going for it. Because the body gets the protein and it gives a certain buzz. And then they're worried about this new generation taking steroids. Because it gets to a point, especially women, that it gets to a point where they're very, very image conscious, body conscious, really focused, and then, okay, well, what's the next thing? Okay, now it's this. Now I take some steroids along with it. And then where does that lead? Tried steroids, but I've seen people that have, and it's not good for the mind. One minute you're happy, and then you have this mad mood swing where somebody just says something innocuous to you, and you get angry, and you don't know why. I saw this again with my mother, because she got put on steroids by the doctor when she went through her menopause. And literally, one minute she'd be happy, and then the next minute she'd be like angry. My mum wasn't an angry woman. Many other things, but she wasn't angry. So to see that all of a sudden, someone that wasn't angry ever, to all of a sudden be angry for no reason, And she disturbed her. She was like, "Why am I angry? I don't know why I'm angry." So you see, these things are there. Now the austerity comes into it. It's not so much, okay, yes, if you don't take on intoxication, then everything's going to be fine. But no intoxication is the kind of foundation for the rest of the austerity. You get used to actually controlling the mind and the senses, controlling our material desires. Now, that sounds not very nice, be happy. The reason it's there is because, two main reasons. One, the main one, is that we don't want to be convinced that we can get happiness from material nature. And pretty much, we are convinced of that. I remember my spiritual master, he once said that, it was during the marathon, and we were talking about working long hours, about 12 hours. And people reminded me of this yesterday, because he's been doing some 12-hour shifts at work, where they're just telling him, like, okay, yeah, you've got to work these hours now, because so-and-so hasn't turned up. And it's not in his contract, but it's like, well, this is what you have to do. And we were talking about doing these 12-hour shifts on Sankirtan. And I was saying, yeah, the reward's there, but it's tiring. But, you know, we do it because you get convinced, and we had been doing that marathon especially, a lot of long hours, both with the driving, both the driving and on the street. I remember one particular week, which I can't even conceive of it now, driving 3 hours to a spot in the morning, doing, like, you know, getting there for 8:30 on the street and then finishing at 9 o'clock at night and then driving another 2.5 hours to another spot that night. And then the next day getting up, chanting around, getting on the street for 8:30 again and then working till 8:30 because it was late night shopping in that place. And then driving back to the spot with them the day before, another 2.5 hours back to get on the street again at 8:30 to do another late night shopping till 9 o'clock. And it was like that, and you kind of, you know, in the mornings, it was difficult. You're standing on the street and there's people there and you're kind of like, how am I going to do this? And that was just a few days of that. And then I was speaking to Maharaj, and he said, yeah, to do that you have to get convinced of Krishna consciousness. And he says, and this is the trick, because when we're not devotees, the whole world has to work these kind of shifts because they're convinced by material energies and give them happiness. So they perform austerity. So the principle of austerity is there. It's where you focus the austerity. Now, for the non-devotee, the austerity is, okay, we work jobs we don't like, we work long hours because we're convinced, okay, at the end of that, we'll get our material gratification. Whether it's from enjoying material opulences, or whether, as it became when the working classes kind of grew in the Middle Ages because the king was just taxing everyone so harshly, that then the austerity is then the power thing of, like, yes, I can do a good hard day's graft. And you see in working class communities, labor-based communities, that's their sense gratification. It's not their wages because they don't get paid enough, it's the gratification, yeah, I did a good hard day's work today. Which I never got my head on that. It's like, why? You worked hard and now you're happy? It's like, you've got no money. But a good hard day's graft. So that's just stupid. But you get convinced, yes, okay, I can't have this, but I have this. So material energy convinces. That even then the austerity becomes the falsehood, the prize. So they perform the austerity. It's like Mayavada philosophy, if you spiritualize it. Yes, they perform the austerity, they have the harshness, very, very strict, and at the end of it, what is it? It's like, you know, I'm really strict. But we see how that leads to the next one, mercy. So if you don't have austerity, there's no question of mercy. You just become hard-hearted. So even you see these Mayavadis, they're exceptionally austere, but where's the mercy? Yes, they're vegetarian, They may be vegan, they may even sweep the floor away from ants, but they're doing it so they don't incur any karma. Not out of any sense of mercy, because then when other people come, they're very harsh to them. They're very, like, you know, as we see in the Chaitanya Charitamrita, and Lord Chaitanya goes and sees the Bodhananda Sarasvati's group, they just laugh at Lord Chaitanya, they insult him, because there's no mercy. Now Lord Chaitanya, out of his humility, converts them all, but the initial response is, okay, there's harshness, there's mocking, there's, oh, you don't understand. You're from this group, so yes, that's the simple terms. You don't understand the dampness. We may experience similar things. Even people that are very intellectual, very knowledgeable, they may practice austerities, and they still have the same view. Oh, you're just chanting Hare Krishna. Or, oh, you're doing all these services, oh, the same. Because there's no mercy. And in that mercy, there's no humility. And that humility, well, Lord Chaitanya says in Shikshastra, isn't it? And that's the foundation of our chanting. It's, is it Sankhya? So that's our Siddha Pramada, our Pramada piece of chant, the humble state of mind. So none of that can develop if there's no austerity. But the austerity has to be focused towards Krishna consciousness. Not just towards, well, austerity for austerity's sake. I remember Dyer's brother telling me once, when he was younger, I don't know where he got the idea, but he used to get into these different austerities. And he would get focused on one of them, and he gets into his martial arts and stuff, and he'd punch these walls, just for hours on end, just be there punching these walls. It's austere. Practicing the approaching, probably thinking one day, you know, one day the chi will flow through his fist and it'll be like the iron fist and the wall will explode and then he can grow his long white beard and his long white hair and kind of go off into the coming through the wilderness or something. But the austerity, the nature is there. But it's okay, why are we doing it? Now at the moment, we're convinced, like I said, of material energy. So most of our austerities that we perform is because it is part of the process. We don't like them, but we do them. The easy austerity is prashadam. But even that over time then, it's like, oh, well, okay. I'll just have a little bag of Christmas. Or a little bag of chocolate. Oh, yeah, there's this. Now, Guru Govinda Swami, he makes a very heavy statement. He basically says, okay, if you eat anything that's not prasadam, then you're going to fall down. He doesn't say, oh, you might, or you've got to watch out because of this, this, and this, and or you just have to accept that, yeah, when you eat that food stuff, it's going to have an effect on you because, well, it's not prasadam, how many Sri Vishnus we give it? It's not. It's a process by which Boga becomes Prashad and Sri Vishnu, and it isn't that process. Might make us feel better that we've at least acknowledged some kind of like, well, yeah, before I enjoy this, I'm going to do this quick thing, and I'm acknowledging that it comes from Krishna. That's nice. It's not Prashad. Where's the love? Prashadam becomes prashadam because there's an exchange of love. Not because we've offered something back to Krishna. Because we've offered it with love and devotion. Perfect. it's because we've done it with love. So the austerity is, you know, at first it's austere, isn't it? We're hungry, we may want to eat something. But we have to go through this whole process of offering, and you know, if we're super strict, like sometimes my wife, when she's offering something and I'm hungry, and you know, the offering's been on there for a minute or something like that, and I'm like, is Krishna eating yet? Yeah. I'm sure he's eating. Krishna's eating, he's told me he's quit today. He's in a row. Thanks for my wife's devotional. She's like, no, not yet. But we have standards then with deities. It's like, no, this is how long it's on there for. And that's an austerity for us to wait. Like we've cooked, now we have to wait while Krishna eats. So that's a practice of austerity, which leads to devotion and love. But to start off with, we're doing it. Okay, here's an austerity. We say these prayers, we understand the act using our intelligence, having received knowledge from different gurus, that we can perform this act of devotion, which the foundation of it is an austerity, but it will lead to love and devotion. So the austerity becomes something sweet. It's not an austerity anymore. And that frees us then from that material attachment. Performing austerity materially for a material gratification, well, it's not that the austerity becomes gratifying, and unless you're a socialist. But if, you know, it's like, okay, I perform this austerity, I hate it, but here's my gratification. Now the process of moving that austerity towards Krishna is then the austerity itself becomes sweet. Because it becomes an act of devotion after a while. It develops within the heart and it becomes an act of bhakti, because everything connected with Krishna becomes sweet. So then where's the question of austerity anymore? And that's why we hear this phrase, make the mind your friend. Because the mind, as anyone who's heard of Kundalini Prabhu's talks, just pretty much is presenting stuff to you that you've enjoyed before. That you trained your mind to sing, whether it's this lifetime or past lifetimes. That you trained your mind to, this is what we enjoy. And so the senses are pretty much in control. But the mind just gives you stuff, I suppose we're chewing the tube, gives you stuff that you've had before. And we've all experienced that, right? When there's something new, the mind doesn't go, hey, the mind goes, hang on, am I going to enjoy this? And you get some fear, like, oh, I might not enjoy it. There's all these other things. And then other people might have to say, no, you can enjoy it when you try it. And you're like, okay, yeah, I enjoy it. Whereas if other people are like, no, you really aren't going to enjoy that. I tend to shy away. So if we've put into practice through austerity that we enjoy these devotional activities, then the mind eventually is trained to say, oh, okay, I'm unhappy, I want to enjoy. And it says, okay, chant Hare Krishna. Or, oh, cook something for Krishna. Or, go and do some service. Or, go to the temple. So generally our experience is, when we want to feel happy, the mind at the moment may not be presenting those things. Our intelligence may present them, but our mind generally doesn't. Generally our mind is then like, you know, on the mind, if you're having a hard day and you've had enough of life, it's like the mind presents our excuse. So you toddle off and go to bed and everything's great again. You forget all that. It doesn't say, oh yeah, chant, or oh yeah, read, oh yeah, go and do some service, or go to the temple, do some kirtan. The intelligence does. So it's okay, this is what we need, to stay strong in the association. You need the holy name, you need service, you need kirtan, you need the devotees. Generally, if we're going out in Harinam, we're not all like, you know, we have to get the mind into it. It's like, oh, Harinam, oh, the mind is listening to the Dharma, it's preaching, it's doing it, it's doing it. But then there comes a certain point sometimes when you're like, you know, in the Harinam, all of a sudden it's, you start enjoying it. It's fun. It's no longer an austerity, it's something you don't want to do. Like the India Day parade the other day, a whole lot different for me at the start was like, no affection for Gandhi. And the baseball caps. But then it becomes, because we're connecting it, okay, it's connected with the holy name. We're doing kirtan. So then all of a sudden, well, whether it's an India Day parade or whatever day parade or anything, it becomes, austerity goes and it becomes something which is enjoyable just automatically because it's the holy name. And you're giving the holy name out. Which, when we preach, which we'll get to, that's something entirely on another level than just practicing these practices for our own spiritual development, which we do. But then when that's dovetailed to its preaching, it's a whole other level of experience. So we see anyway, one, controlling the mind, making the mind our friend, practicing the austerity because we have to anyway, but focusing it towards Krishna and service then purifies austerity so it becomes sweet. And then that helps us go through the mode because we're not getting affected anymore. Anyone who's read the Three Modes of Nature and the Bhagavad Gita in the river, so you have to climb through them. You don't do that without practicing austerity. Because generally we're inclined towards the mode of ignorance, so it's austere for us to not be in ignorance anymore. We like the mode of ignorance. Yeah, we don't have to take responsibility for the mode of ignorance. It's just, yeah, whatever, I don't know what the consequences, but anyway, yeah, I'm going to do it. I don't have to think, I don't have to really act, I don't have to be responsible, yeah, fine. But when we go up from that, all of a sudden it's an austerity, because we have to think, we have to use our intelligence. We generally don't like using our intelligence in Kali Yuga, because it requires thought and responsibility. We want an easy life. So when we have to think and use it for austerity, not because, oh, it's within some fame or some fortune or some kudos, but because, okay, yes, this is to perform an austerity. We don't like it. It's a lot easier to be in ignorance where, well, it doesn't matter, we don't know, but anyway, my mind's not giving a problem. So through austerity, the modes become easy to find through. Because we can perform the austerity. Again, always with that focus that this is for Krishna. Trains us. And then, get to the next one then. When we're in that point where the austerity is like, we understand why we're performing that, then we're not in the mode of ignorance anymore. When we're performing austerity just for material pleasure, generally we're in the mode of ignorance and passion. If we're lucky, we're in the mode of passion, like you see most of the business world, they perform austerity because it's like, yes, we're going to be rich. And then we can have, you know, all this lifestyle and everything will be fine. There was an earthquake in Bali last week. Now, what the news outlets focused on wasn't so much the earthquake in Bali and the damage it was doing to the Balinese and the Indonesian people, because it affected the whole area. It was like, oh, well, yeah, the Beckhams were on holiday in Bali and they got caught up in the earthquake, but now they've gone to this other place. So they're safe. Anyone that's worried? Beckhams are all right. It's crazy. Yet for the thousands of other people that are affected by the earthquake, you know, it's not fair. So we see, yes, the rich mode of passion. They're thinking we can have this paradise holiday. If it gets interrupted, well, we'll have enough money that we can just get away from it and go to another paradise, where our sense gratification doesn't get interrupted. So that's mode of passion, motivated. This is our goal, this is how we get there. But most of us are in the mode of ignorance. We don't really know why, what's going on, but we get some activity and we get some mild form of material pleasure maybe. We can find through that when we start performing these same austerities, but towards Krishna. And then there's austerities, we increase them from away from the material gratification. So the austerity isn't just anymore, well, I have to work, and Krishna says you're entitled to work. But then the fruits of that, the material fruits, we're not entitled to that, surrender those to Krishna. So then that's an austerity. And we see, isn't it, that we heard in class the other week, that the different austerities for the different classes, so the brahmachari, you know, the austerities, they surrender their intelligence, they leave their activities. Grihastha surrenders their time and their money. So you see the different forms of austerity that we surrender, okay, we take it a step further then, when we perform the simple austerities and get a taste for it because it's towards Krishna, so they're not austere anymore, they're sweet. And then we can elevate to the next austerities, which is not being convinced that material energy can give us pleasure. So we shy away from the activities of the materialist. So that goes beyond just the regulative principle of no intoxication. It means we don't perform the activities that material energy is presenting as enjoyable. Any of them, not just the gross ones, not just the grossly intoxifying ones, but we move away from all of them, and some of them are very subtle. Like I said, the last stumbling block on the path of devotion is pride. Because, you know, you become a very famous devotee, you become a very, suppose, a big devotee, you're very strict, you've got everything there, and the last stumbling block is that you think you've done it. Or getting the praise. So we have that. It's very subtle. We all have that, we like a pat on the head, we like some, what's the word now? Acknowledgement of our activities, our devotion. Which is nice, you know, we should, as devotees, we should be willing to praise other devotees, but not be after praise ourselves. Again, that verse, the foundation is so that principle's there, and we take it further then. That yes, our gratification, our sense gratification becomes spiritualized because it's all to do with Krishna. Then performing that austerity leads to that. But that doesn't just come without the austerity. Because we can't say, oh, yeah, I'm doing Krishna service, purifying my heart, focusing my activities here, but actually when I want to be happy, I'm going to material energy. And we see material energy is very expert at trying to convince us how to do this, with the marketing, the advertising, the movies, the TV, pushing us to actually be more engrossed in Kali Yuga's activities. More degraded activities. Don't know if you've noticed, maybe not, but I have, certainly since I joined, the presentation of sense gratification that material energy gives has become more degraded. Because that keeps us lower and lower and lower until energy can push us down even more and more and more. So we go further away from Krishna, which makes it harder to get close. And she's up the ante. I mean, the last 20 years is phenomenal. I remember there being uproar. It was a bit gross, but being uproar and of course a national scandal when I was a student with this Wonder Bra advert. That it had a woman in a bra on a billboard, and it was like, you can't do that. And it was like a scandal all over the country. Now, it's almost like if you don't do that, you're not advertising. It's, you know, whatever you're using, some connection. But it's become the norm, to the point that if you're not doing it, it's a problem. So it degrades. We want to get away from that. So the austerities aren't just necessarily the regular principles of non-intoxication. The austerity is more than that. The way to get free of it is, yes, we become convinced that material energy can't give us pleasure. Now that's the initial austerity, is then we go to the activities which are actually pleasurable, and we perform them. Even though we may not get so much pleasure out of them, and the mind may be going, I don't want to do that. But by doing them, we're connecting with Krishna, they're pleasurable, and then we get a taste of Krishna consciousness. And then we get to the point of like, okay, this isn't austere anymore, this is actually what I want to do. The mind's trained, yes. Feeling sad, chanting Krishna. When you start to investigate the mind, you realize pretty much everything we do is filtered through the mind. So if we're not making the mind our friend, we're finished. It's always going to be a battle. But if we get to the point where our mind, when we're feeling sad, says, oh, why don't you chant? Then that's what we want to do. Then spontaneous devotion can start to arise because you're not having to use your intelligence to focus it, you haven't been instructed, it's just all of a sudden you want to do something. Through that austerity focused through Krishna, then mercy, real mercy, comes. Now, mercy again is more than just, oh yeah, we're vegetarian. That's how the foundation for mercy to grow from, But mercy, the principle of mercy, is far, far, far greater than just like, well, we don't eat meat. Again, that's the gross foundation from which mercy can grow, which is why it's our regulative principle. So we have at least the building blocks there to start from. But it's not the be-all and end-all. Rabbits are vegetarian. Very hard for a rabbit to perform that. Very hard for a rabbit to do anything but breed and eat lettuce. So they're following this regulative principle of vegetarianism, no meat, fish or eggs. But that's it. Nothing else. So many people are vegetarian and vegans. So now we've experienced from our Facebook interactions that just from this principle of veganism, which is a wonderful principle, it doesn't necessarily lead to bhakti and a fondness for Krishna. Our experience has been quite the opposite. Many vegans don't like Krishna. All Krishna's devotees. Many do, but many don't. So we can see just that principle on its own isn't going to develop Krishna consciousness. It's the foundation. You know, if you have a strong foundation, then the rest can grow. So it's the starting block. It's that springboard by which mercy can develop. Now, it's the harshest one because, well, pretty much in the material world, we realize from this one, this particular principle, that it's impossible, completely impossible, to live in the material world without killing some living entity. Can't do it. You know, we're breathing, there's microbes which are living, and they're going to die. Just because we're breathing. We can't do anything about it. We go out in the street, we're going to walk on so many living entities. We have these ants that crawl around there. And we know it's impossible to avoid them. You try, and you end up doing some little jig. But every now and again, some poor ant, while you're doing your little jig to avoid one, another one's going to end up. Oh, can't help it. And we have to eat. And vegetables are living entities, they're plants, they grow. So we may not be eating meat, fish or eggs, we're eating vegetables, and well, we have to kill them to eat them. There's no getting away from it. So again, that reminds us, actually, yes, in this material world, you can't get away from incurring karma. Pause the Bhagavad Gita and the Bhagavad Gita say it. You can't become free from sin in the material world, living material. It's impossible. No matter how good a person we are, no matter how austere we are, no matter how many philanthropic activities we do, you can't get away from it. Which is interesting, because this reminds me of getting to a whole linguistic aside now. There's finding this out and reading about it and studying, thinking about this principle of mercy, the linguistics of the word mercy sounds like a French word, right? Mercy. Well, it's because the foundation of both of them are exactly the same. The word developed, I think, in the 1100s, or was that the 12th century, and it meant wages. It was like, okay, here's your wage, here's your mercy. Now, how mercy then developed in French to become a word to say thank you, and how mercy developed in English to mean, like, you know, some sense of like, oh, you know, I'm going to forgive you, or some kind of sense of clemency that, oh yeah, you're not going to, you know, I'm showing you mercy, so you're not going to die. I don't know. But the original meaning of mercy meant wages. So you equate that with the biblical propaganda of that time as well, which was starting to be quite puritanical. That mercy, so you have this very famous phrase which Christians like to throw at us on the street, that, you know, the wages of sin are death. So the mercy of sin is death. Now we understand that to be spiritual suicide, but yes, you have to die and you have to take birth again. So then this mercy, the wage of our activities, so how does that apply them? What's that mercy? So the linguistics of it don't seem to fit. But the later one that we understand, again, the Sanskrit would be more like Hinsa, that we practice non-violence. But it goes higher than that, this sense of Mondo mercy. That yes, we have control over certain things, and so we show mercy. We're kind, we're generous, we're gentle. That's something that develops. But the original meaning, this idea of like wages, well, that's interesting, because then that brings into the karma aspect of like, okay, here's your karma for this activity, here's your karma. So it's not enough just to be vegetarian, because that still has karma. The wages of that, the mercy of just being vegetarian, is not enough. So then we have to get into the principle again, everything focused on why have we got this principle there, how does that develop our Krishna consciousness? When we connect Krishna to that principle of mercy, then we understand, well, okay, to actually become sinless, to have no wages, or the wages of our activity being bhakti, which is true mercy, that you give people Krishna consciousness, then it has to be connected up. So why are we vegetarian? Why do we have that regulative principle? It's not for any humanity, it's not for environmental reasons, it's not because, you know, any ethical or moral reasons. It's because Krishna says, if you offer these things to me with love and devotion, I'll accept them. And that way you become free from your karmic debt of eating this. So then that's accepting, actually, yes, the material world is a bad situation. Again, getting to this point that we're not convinced that material energy can make us happy. Here's this principle that's shown us, the material world is a bad situation, and you can't get away from that fact. The only way to get away from it is actually to offer everything to Krishna. And here's Krishna saying, this is what you can offer me. Nothing else. And then we just take that. Now, we often say, oh, yeah, translation of prasadam is mercy. Because it's karma free, it's full of bhakti, it's a reciprocation of Krishna's love towards us. Now, that's true mercy. So then that gets the kind of moving on from that foundation of, you know, not feasting off death, or the worst type of death. You know, we have different levels of species. We know that animal killing, it affects the consciousness, and it's the highest sense gratification that there is killing another living entity that's more conscious. It's described that the highest type of sense gratification in the material world is killing another human. That because ultimately that's the power of God. So it's the highest gratification. It also has the most serious karmic reaction, more than any others. It takes an intoxication where we accept, okay, that's going to affect my mind, my senses, it's going to drag me towards material energy instead of towards Krishna's direct energy. But karmically, well, I may perform some activities when I'm intoxicated, but the act of intoxication itself doesn't have as much karmic depth to it as the act of killing. Naturally the soul wants to enjoy, but an act of killing, well, that's just something that happens under Krishna's direction and moves from through the world, that's down to him to do. When we do it, we actively say, okay, well, I'm not killing, I'm going to do this and I'm going to enjoy it. That's twisted to the highest degree. It's taking this sense of proprietorship to the highest level. This idea that I am God, I'm going to do it. So the sin that's incurred from that is the highest. So Krishna says, okay, here's the lowest common denominator, this food stuff. Every animal has to live off another animal in this bad situation. So making the best of a bad bargain, you eat this, it's still going to incur sin. It's not as heavy as these ones, because the consciousness isn't as apparent. But the way you become free of that sin then is you offer it to me with love and devotion. That's the only thing that frees from that sin. So you go to the lowest consciousness. the fruits, the vegetables, and you take their fruits and you offer to Krishna. It's not a perfect situation, it's not a nice situation, but it's the best use of a bad bargain. So we understand, yes, you can't avoid it. Material energy is not a good place. But Krishna's saying, okay, here's the concession. You're here, you're in the prison, you're all naughty boys and girls. Now, this is what I'll accept. Here's the caveat, you have to offer it to me with love and devotion. Because mine, it's no good just to offer it to me, it has to be done with love and devotion. And then, when you give that out, it becomes my prasadam, my mercy. Because then people taste, you taste, and then other people taste this reciprocation of Krishna. They taste Krishna's love in that food. So there's no more sin, there's no more negativity, there's no more karma. It's just tasting Krishna's love and devotion, and the love and devotion of his devotee. And then that principle expands out when you get to the next thing. When you develop this basic thing of offering prasad and being able to do it, the basic principle of that, then mercy can grow out of that. Because the principle is there. And then we realize, well, okay, yeah, it's not just about that one principle. Mercy becomes about giving Krishna to everyone else. Because that's the only thing that's actually merciful. And the type of mercy. Now, the other type of mercy, the wages, well, yeah, we may do so many things and it may sort people out materially, but if it's not connected to Krishna and bring them to Krishna, then the type of wage it is the type that the Bible was talking about. It's repeated birth and death. That's not what we want. We want people to get Krishna. So from that foundation of developing mercy, that simple act of offering food to Krishna that he'll accept, with love and devotion, and then taking that, then propels us into preaching. So then we realize, okay, yeah, how important prasadam is. That a lot of my Prabhupada said, it's on the attack, book distribution, harinam, prasadam distribution. Because from prasadam, this sense of bhakti grows within the heart. From prasadam then, this sense of mercy grows out, and then we can preach. From that sense of mercy, we can then start to become a via medium by which Lord Chaitanya's mission can flow through, which is ultimately what we want to do. We're not trying to enjoy Krishna. We're not seeing like, okay, yeah, I want to enjoy the material world, yeah, put it down, the material world can't give me happiness, but if I chant with Krishna and do these activities, then I can enjoy Krishna. That's not what we're after. That's not love. That's the same problem. We just spiritualized it. Which is better than materializing it, but it's not what we're after. What we're after is to become a servant. Not just a sense of Krishna, but a servant of a servant of a servant. Which means preaching. So then we see the foundation becoming free from, these principles of degradation. By following the four waves, examining how they interact with each other, how they help us, give us the foundation by which all these other principles can grow out of, helps give us the foundation of being able to preach properly, which is why they are so important, because they are the pillars by which we preach. Now, Vedically, they're the pillars of religion. For us, they're the pillars of our preaching. Because we don't want to just perform religious principles. Lord Chaitanya's mood was wanting to give out Krishna consciousness. It's that famous verse in the CC that says, I'm but one gardener and there's so many fruits to give out and to pick. Who's going to help? If we're applying these principles properly, then naturally we can actually then become a via medium by which these fruits of bhakti can be given out. Which is our goal. That is our goal. Because when we're preaching, that's the direct experience of bhakti. because all of a sudden we're taking on the mood of the resonance of Vrindavan, which is just to bring everyone to the Krishna's lotus feet. Resonance of Vrindavan, their whole life is Krishna. Everything they do is for Krishna. Everybody that comes to visit Vrindavan, the residents of Vrindavan, they just talk to them about Krishna, and then they try and engage them in doing something for Krishna. When Lord Shiva goes to visit Krishna, when he's a baby, Mother Yashoda doesn't let him in, not because, like, you know, he has Satan. She's like, no, no, there's no way I'm letting Krishna see this. Krishna's going to cry if he sees this. And Lord Shiva would have been ash. Snakes, voice like thunder, kind of big trident. Yeah. Any mother's going to be like, no, I'm not letting this man in England, he might kill. She wasn't thinking, oh, this is a cheater. She's like, no way. I don't care who you are. Krishna's going to take you just like that. Because she's just thinking Krishna. Destroyer of the universe, you know. She wasn't scared. She's like, nope, you're going to make my baby cry. She's just thinking about Krishna. No, there's like, she goes away completely, like, destroy, he can't do anything. It's destroyer of worlds. Destroyer of the universe. Everyone else in the universe is like, yeah, you've got to be respectful to the Shiva. And here he is, you know, Mother Yashoda, simple cowherd wife. And he goes away, like completely dejected. He doesn't come and say, hey, I'm coming in. And Lord Shiva stand aside and, you know, fling her away. Yeah. He's like, can't do anything. And then it takes another minute to come and say, oh, this is how you have to approach. So please, Krishna. And Krishna's there thinking, I want to see Lord Shiva, he's my greatest devotee. But it has to be arranged so that his mother's okay with it. That's the mood of the resonance of Vrindavan, always thinking of Krishna, always thinking of Krishna, how is this pleasing to Krishna? Which is how we want to get to. And we do that by preaching, by giving other people Krishna. Now, you can't give somebody something if you haven't got it. Which is the wonderful thing about preaching in Lord Chaitanya's mission, is before, when Krishna comes and speaks about the Gita, he says, Sarvadhanam Prajaja, you have to surrender completely to me, you have to get to this point of unequivocal love, and then I'll give it to you. Lord Chaitanya, he just says, I have this fruit, and the only condition that he gives is, who wants to help me? So he asks the question, do you want to help me? Come and help me. He doesn't say, okay, first you surrender, then you can help me. Or first we follow all these practices, then you can help me. He says, okay, do you want to help me? And if you say yes, he's like, okay, here you go, I've brought these fruits. So automatically, by us saying yes, we want to preach, we want to give Krishna to others, then, well, for us to give it, which Lord Chaitanya is saying, yeah, we get it. He gives it to us. That's what it says. If we're a via medium, it comes through us. So part of the principle is, if we're giving it to this person, from this person, well, it passes through us, which means we get it. So all these principles, everything there is to help get us to that point where we can be a via medium by which we can actually say, yes, I want to help you. Then automatically, all these principles of bhakti naturally come. Which is why we're here, isn't it? Yes, if you practice these rules, regulations, if you follow this process, this science of Krishna consciousness, you don't have to go out of your way to imagine devotion. It automatically arises within the heart. So we don't have to become sahajas. We don't have to read things and go, now I have to put effort into trying to think like a gopi. No. If we follow the sciences given to us by the Bhagavad Gita and Bhagavatam, laying these foundations, then automatically that will arise. So then we see again how important these foundations are, these four principles. Because they, again, they're the foundations by which this bhakti can automatically arise. They're the foundation by which we can chant nicely. The foundation of our devotional practice, when they're focused towards Krishna. moods as well. But we just want to love Krishna, become his devotee, focus on him. Simple for the simple. We have a whole science because we're complicated. We have to be convinced to give up this addiction we have towards thinking that material energy can make us happy. So these foundations we've been talking about, they give us that foundation by which we can be convinced. They give us the foundation, the pillars of success by which we then stop looking to material energy for our sense gratification, and we become convinced by Krishna consciousness. When we're convinced by Krishna consciousness, then we'll actually genuinely turn out to look at him and say, yes, I want to help you distribute those fruits. You distribute the fruits, and those fruits naturally arise within our hearts, the fruit of bhakti. Then we become pure lovers of Krishna, and then we go home back to Vrindavan.